Hi, everyone. I am Variety Senior Editor Michael Schneider, and thank you for joining us for this edition of the SAG-AFTRA Foundation Conversations. This time out, we're talking about City of Angels, the next chapter in the Penny Dreadful saga created by John Logan on Showtime. It's a really fantastic series. Season one just completed. You can go right now over to Showtime and watch all 10 episodes. The very timely series, even though it takes place in 1940s Los Angeles, it deals with issues we're talking about all the time right now in terms of class, race, power, and there's a little supernatural in it as well, since it is a Penny Dreadful story. Really interesting, timely show that takes place, nearly 80 years ago. But we have some of the stars of City of Angels, Penny Dreadful, to join us and talk about their experience in being a part of this series, this such interesting series. So let me introduce them right now. First off, she plays the Vega family matriarch on the show. These are all Vegas today, by the way. They're all here. Adriana Barraza. She's an Oscar nominee for Babel. You've seen her in From Prada to Nada, Rambo Last Blood, Drag Me to Hell, The Strain, so much more, including so much in Spanish language media as well. Thank you so much. She plays, of course, Maria Vega, the matriarch, like I mentioned on the show. Adriana, thank you for joining us.
No, thank you. Thank you for having me. Thank you very much.
Absolutely. Next up, you've seen him in CSI Miami, Criminal Minds, Ugly Betty, Jane the Virgin, and of course, Magic Mike. Can't forget Magic Mike. He plays Raul Vega, the older brother on the show, Adam Rodriguez. Adam, thank you so much for joining us.
Great.
Good, good. We're going to talk nothing but Magic Mike for the next 25 minutes. I don't know if they told you.
That, right? Yeah.
and finally, one of the stars of the show, he plays Tiago, the new LAPD detective in City of Angels. You've seen him in Here and Now, Revenge, Fear the Walking Dead, and so much more. Daniel Zovatto. Daniel, thank you for joining us.
Thank you, Michael.
Absolutely, absolutely. Well, like I said, this is such a special project, and I love that we have the Vegas, but most of the Vegas. We're missing two of them today because that family is so much an important part of this series as well. But I want to kick it back a notch, and let's talk about how you all got involved with this project. And Daniel, I'll start with you in how you first learned of this project. Did you read it? How did you talk to John Logan about it? What was your sort of experience in getting involved with City of Angels?
Well, my process was, very normal. Your agents call you and tell you that there's this opportunity, there's this really cool role. They kind of pitch you the story of what they kind of know about it. And then I went and I got the sides, and I got them like the day before. So I only had like 24 hours to prepare this, which was kind of, nerve-wracking. You go in, you read for Michael and John Logan, and that process was like, a 3 to 4 month thing where I kept on going and coming back. And as John said, he put me through the ringer, which he did. And it was one of the most beautiful audition processes I've ever had. So,
yeah. What did you make of the story and of the character early on? And what made you interested in really pursuing the role of Tiago?
Yeah, well, John kind of kept, he didn't tell, he kept everything under wraps, but he kind of gave you like little breadcrumbs. He kind of sees Tiago as his Hamlet, and it's when you hear that as an actor, it's kind of nerve-wracking, and you know that you're going to be going through a roller coaster of emotions. Tiago is a person that's split. He is a Chicano, but he's also part of the LAPD, and he's the first one. So he doesn't have anybody that he can kind of, feel like they're going through the same experience. So he's kind of stuck in the middle, and he's gone through a lot. And as you said, the supernatural element is also a big part of Tiago's, storyline. So it's a very complex character. And that kind of, challenge was something that I really wanted to tackle. And also, the humanity aspect of Tiago, because he kind of is, a big part of the heart of the family.
Yeah, yeah. We'll talk more specifically about the challenges Tiago faces in a bit. But first, I want to turn it over to Adriana now. And sort of similar question in some ways, your character Maria is the link to some of the supernatural elements. in the show. What intrigued you about Maria and playing this role?
Well, Maria Vega is a wonderful, wonderful Mexican woman. And she is so strong. She's a great mother, father. She is a widower, and she work a lot to raise her children. Maria Vega has a wonderful key to the supernatural world, not only because she is Mexican, it's because she has wonderful roots, Aztec roots. I work with John about this, and I asked him about because I studied how many ways you can, as a Mexican, you can have this kind of actitudes, ¿cómo se diría? Skills. And then I discover it's my heritage with John Logan and me talking about that. And then this is the reason because Maria can see that supernatural world, not only Santa Muerte, as well Magda, and not only see, she can communicate it with them. And I really enjoy, you know, because it's not only a wonderful character in like a mother or like a human and strong human being, as well as a woman who can speak and spell and every kind of wonderful things, I think.
Yeah, and it's so fascinating because obviously her children are all being pulled in every direction, and to see her deal with that throughout the series is amazing to watch. Adam, let's talk about Raul because he's sort of the conscience of this family. He's the activist. You know, he's the one who's out there early on, you know, trying to protect his community as they're building this freeway to sort of dissect and destroy their neighborhood, their community. And early on, that impacts him greatly, and that puts him at odds with his brother. This is a pretty meaty role as well. Talk about how you got involved with the show.
Yeah, I mean, in terms of getting involved with the show, I was lucky enough to just have a meeting with John and Michael. I had read the script prior to the meeting. I fell in love with the script and became really impassioned about it, and did several hours of my own research just to prepare for the meeting, because I mean, really did it just out of interest. I was so engaged in the material that I wanted to know more about the time period, more about the history, and really start digging, you know, into what was really going on from a historical standpoint before that time period and then into that time period. And I became fascinated about all of this history in Los Angeles that I wasn't aware of, that was incorporated into the show. So I went into the meeting, you know, with quite a bit of knowledge, you know, especially just in terms of being prepared for a meeting. And I think we all just really clicked. We talked about the character and what he was about and how he was going to serve the story. And we talked about the history and sort of the message that John was really trying to deliver in telling the story. And I think the three of us just realized we had clicked, we were on the same page with it. And I was lucky enough to get the job. You know, I think that they agreed and they offered me the job, and I was really, really excited about this character in particular, because he is the other voice in the house. You know, Mama is really the one stuck in the middle. Tiago is stuck in the middle in his own way, because he's stuck in the middle between the profession that he's chosen and who he actually is, where he comes from. And that's a tough battle to be fighting. And most especially when the other half of your family, your eldest brother, is on the opposite side of that argument. You know, and that is one of the things I think that Daniel's done so beautifully is balance, you know, the difficulty really of having to be committed to two different things at the same time, you know, and your family is always the main thing, but you know, your job and your family there at your job is a difficult thing too. And Raul, as you see at the beginning of the series, is really impassioned about fighting for his community. He's a union leader. He's a community organizer. And he is at the forefront. He's the tip of the spear of this fight to push back against putting this freeway in the middle of our neighborhood and destroying the jobs and the homes that we've all come to know and work for. And I just think that when I read this role, Raul really spoke to me as being a voice for the people, as having an opportunity to say something for the people that aren't able to express that for themselves. And that just really spoke to me. That was somebody that I've always tried to be when I can in my own life. And then to have a chance to do it artistically was a real treat. I really haven't had a chance to do that before in my career. So I was really excited about it.
Yeah, and obviously having his brother, be an LAPD officer makes things a little awkward. And Daniel, one of the central interesting points of this series is Tiago stuck between worlds and sort of, his community feeling like maybe he's turning his back on them because he's going to the other side. But then obviously the LAPD is not welcoming him with open arms and he's having to fight from within there too. So he's stuck between both worlds, neither of which really understand him. That's a fantastic role. And talk about attacking that and sort of, enveloping this character who is sort of caught between two worlds.
Yeah, I mean, look, I got really lucky. I have obviously, Adriana and Adam. Nathan is not here, but he's my partner, and having him as a North Star, somebody who's so seasoned. I mean, he's been acting for longer than I've been alive.
So, I'm sure he's thrilled when you say that.
He loves when I say that. Yeah. But it's just having that, I don't know, it kind of gave me this, I don't know, that fear of not being able to do it. I mean, that's something that fuels me. I like a challenge. So in many ways, like, I feel like having him next to me, made things better. It's just having, being able to work with people like Adriana and like Nathan. It's just great. You learn a lot from them. And, I do think that when you play that role, you have to be as honest and as just wearing your heart on your hands, because in many ways, Tiago was the first one. And being the first one at anything is going to be hard. You're always going to be criticized. You're always going to be looked down. You're never going to be the right fit, And I think that's one of the best lines in the show. It's when my mom and I are walking and she says, "You're the one who's going to help the next one." And in many ways, I feel like that's one of the things that he keeps replaying. At least when I played, Tiago, it was one of the things that kept me going. It's, you're doing this for the next man, as much as Raul is doing that for the union and for our people, I think that I'm doing the same. Yeah. But in a world where we haven't been seen yet or accepted for being just a Chicano, for being a Mexican. So I think that it's just, being honest and being the more human, the better, in my opinion.
Yeah, it's the struggle to become an American. I mean, it's a struggle now, 82 years later, that's still going on. The people that have the right to be American and be in all of the places that they are, regardless of where their heritage is from. And we are still living in a country where, and in a world, unfortunately, where, people want to assign
labels.
They want to make you what they want to make you.
And that's one of the cool things that, the ninth episode, obviously there's a beautiful scene with all the family, and that's kind of like the first time where you see Tiago stand up and say, "Enough is enough. This is who I am. You either accept me for who I am or I don't need you in my life." And that's a hard thing for him to say. Of course he needs his family, but he wants to make sure that they know who he is. And that's one of the things that I think I never thought that it was going to impact people as much, but the amount of people that have been saying, like, "Yo, man, like, that was me. I had to do that with my family." And we're talking about, like, right now. So it's something that keeps happening, and I think that a lot of people can relate to, because sometimes the closest people to you are going to be the ones that are going to keep you, real tight and not let you be who you are. And I think that's one of the beautiful things about this show, that it's about a family. And we are all going in different directions and we're all very different. But our mom raised us right and we're sticking together. And as a family, like all Latino families, and we can testify for this, we go through a lot of crazy shit, but we remain tight and we're always a family, you know?
Yeah.
I think this is one of the beautiful reasons that Penny Dreadful City of Angels is beautiful, because to talk about this kind of family, this kind of interaction between us, I think everybody can feel it the same. And to see these Mexican people too, it's not only Mexican people, because I think John Logan made a wonderful universal work, universal script, because I think he not only talk about like Mexican people, he talked about everybody. And I think John Logan, I don't know why, but John Logan knows a lot about Mexicans. And I really appreciate it. I love him for that.
Yeah, he did. He did his homework. And I had a chance to visit the set, actually, and tour it along with John. And I visited the Vega house. And he was telling me how all of you, the actors playing the Vega family, spend a lot of time there bonding, getting to know each other, sort of playing out this role. Talk a little bit about that, and sort of as a group of actors, sort of spending time inside that house and sort of, you know, bonding in that way and sort of developing this chemistry that we clearly saw on screen.
I think that's the most beautiful thing about all of us. And I just want to chime in. It's that we all wanted to feel like we were in a family. And that house, I mean, the minute you walk in, Michael, you notice that there's life. I mean, Maria Kessa, the production designer, she made it feel like we've been there all our lives. Mm-hmm. So we spent a lot. Adam was, you know, Adam always has amazing food. He knows where to get the good food. So he brought some good food, and we sat in that picnic table. Like I think it was like 2 hours before we started filming, and we all ate, and we're just bonding and just, you know, getting that dynamic going before we got to say a line. You know what I'm saying? Like, it's just, that was, I think. Go ahead, talk, but I think that was...
You nailed it. I mean, Maria did. She created the attention to detail on all of the set pieces on the show. I mean, all of them. But we spent the most time there in the Vega house. And it, from the minute you walk in, and you went, Michael, so I imagine you might have felt the same thing. I don't know if you felt that same connection, but you can definitely tell that every little detail was so well thought out and so cared for and just so beautifully executed that when you are playing a character and you're getting to call this your home, you walk into that space and it absolutely feels like a home, and it feels like a place we all belonged. I think that Maria setting that up for us the way that she did really helped us connect in a way immediately. As soon as we started those rehearsals and then, you know, even deeper when we were actually playing the scenes, it was really something special.
Yeah. Yeah.
But I want to say something. It's not all the time. I work in this profession for many, 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 many years. And it's not all the time that you have a great connection with everybody. It's not necessary, maybe, but in this family, the connection is real, because the connection between us as human beings, not only as an actors, as a human beings, is real. We are in touch with our heart, with our soul, with our mind. Really, really, it was a pleasure for me to have these children. We don't have the little ones, okay? But my children are like my children, like Adriana Barraza, you know? I'm really proud about them, really proud. And I think this is this kind of relationship and this and the screen is in está ahí.
It translates to the screen, yeah.
Yes.
It's up there for sure.
Yeah. Yeah, and you mentioned the little ones. I mean, there's the scene where Mateo watches his sister be assaulted by this cop, and just that pain that you see him go through, and obviously what she goes through, and you know, that's a transformative moment for the entire series, really. Yeah. And you know, to see, you know, what do you do when someone you know, assaults one of your family members, you know, yeah. It's family. So the things that you'll do, and what he has to do and feels like he has to do, you know, to, you know, protect and avenge what happened to his sister, you know, also obviously impacts the show, impacts that family unit, impacts, you know, Adriana, your character's relationship with her son, with her daughter. So again, you know, this all sort of intersects, and it's a real interesting, you know, sort of piece about this family. I guess we just keep going back to that because it is so central to this story.
It is. I really think it is the central part of the entire story is that. I mean, and your family grows with time. I mean, you know, you can see Michener becomes Tiago's family throughout the story. They become connected in a way that's so deep. But Tiago knows how to connect that way because he comes from that kind of a family. And, you know, I think that if that is really the main message, I think, behind all of this, that we are all family and we have to find a way to connect in that way, and the Vegas are the example of that, and you know, however we can try and send that ripple out into the pond more strongly, you know, then we make the world a better place that way. And the community has to start from family. We have to take care of our families the right way. We have to love our families the right way to develop a larger community that's going to be healthy as well, you know. And I don't think you can have one without the other. And I do think that's why the Vegas are the heart of the show.
Yeah. And Adam, you mentioned also sort of the history behind the, you know, the story that John also wanted to tell about the systemic racism and sort of division that, you know, Los Angeles and most, you know, cities across this country have sort of faced through the years. The LA story, of course, is interesting and unique in its own way. And I've been fascinated by it too. And John, again, having visited the set, I went to his office. He had that big map. I mean, he, like, whenever anyone visited, I know he would give his entire history story lesson on the history of Los Angeles. So, yeah, Dan and Adriana, how did you sort of research this? Did you also go through the John Logan boot camp of the history of Los Angeles?
Well, thanks God, this amazing production give us a lot of page of information about every kind of issues in the story. And then I have to speak in Spanish now, I'm sorry.
Oh, no problem.
Pero tuve que, yo supe muchas cosas que no sabía, pero como mexicana, I discovered a lot of things.
Yo supe muchas cosas. I'm sorry. I knew a lot of things as a Mexican woman and as a Mexican, but there's a lot of things that I discovered that I didn't know about the history.
For example, I didn't know about the Nazi thing in LA or the Nazi thing in USA. And then I discovered a wonderful documental in the television about that issue, and wow, it was a thing that I transformed my mind, you know. But especially in Mexican issues, I am a great investigation my whole life, because I love my country and I love my culture. And for example, I know this in this time, I know what kind of issues have the people in LA, the Mexican people in LA. But this is the reason because I said, I really admire the scripts, because John is like, if John knows really deeply about Mexican culture and Mexican people. And obviously I was in El Campamento de John Logan. Yes,
and the boot camp,
John Logan's boot camps. Yeah, of course.
We all went through the boot camp. It was actually really cool because we never really had a table read as you usually have. We actually had kind of like a company meeting, it always felt like we were doing theater. You know, like, and it's because we have theater heads. We had him, John Logan, we had Nathan, we had Brent Spiner. It was theater heads. And you would be hearing about Broadway this, Broadway that the whole time. So it felt like you were in this, like, company back in the day. And, you know, we got to do rehearsals and we got to really, like, just feel really comfortable with our characters and feel like we could do stuff. And it felt like we were rehearsing a play. I don't know if that makes any sense. But it felt unique in that way. And, you know, when it comes to the preparation, you know, I did, you know, my research as well. I read books and stuff about especially what was going on with the Chicanos in that time. You know, I didn't know that people who were actually born here, for example, were kicked out of the country just because they were Mexican, like stuff like that, that I was aware of the history, but not all the little details. And I actually met up with this guy who wrote a book, and he took me to this coffee shop here in LA, which I hadn't been. It's called Homeboy, I believe it's called.
Yeah.
And it's kind of like the epicenter of a lot of the Mexican culture here. And he took me around, kind of showed me all the landmarks and all the different parts that mean a lot to Chicanos here. So it was kind of cool to kind of like walk around and experience this, see the big mural in downtown LA that is still there. So just kind of get into that cultural, you know, feel to it.
Absolutely. And when you drive up the 110 freeway, it's sort of you think of it differently than
yes,
maybe you did
totally.
Before.
All the roads, you're just like, wow. You know?
Yeah.
That was the thing that John was wanted to point out, was that the roads, and they discuss it in the story. I mean, essentially the roads were the boundaries. They were the walls that were trying to be created to separate these neighborhoods and allow ghettos to naturally be created. I mean, or unnaturally by creating the roads. But by doing that, you were going to cordon off certain groups of people from other groups of people and create these divides. And, you know, they had many different options in terms of where to place the roads, but they were very calculated in placing them in areas that they knew were going to separate the undesirables in their minds. The people who had the money didn't want to have to deal with, you know, with the people they didn't want to have to deal with, whether they were Latino, whether they were Black, Jewish, you know, Asian, whatever it was they were trying to eliminate from you know, the culture they wanted to create, they were putting the roads there to purposely eliminate those people. Or to divide them, you know, separate them from themselves. And John really, I mean, talking about that company meeting, Daniel, I mean, John gave one of the most beautiful and impassioned speeches I've ever heard I've ever heard a writer give about his work, and really conveying the messages of that work and the meaning of it, and how important it was for us to carry that meaning through in the work that we were going to deliver. And I mean, that really still, to this day, I mean, I really regret.
I remember not, we all looked around and we were
nobody recorded it. I mean, it was one of those things that you just wish you had recorded, because I
wanted to take pictures, but well, it wasn't for us. Can I have a picture with you? Oh, well, we have a fantastic chat, personal, but I'm sorry, I interrupted my son, please.
No. I agree. It was just a wonderful thing, and it solidified the feeling that I think we all felt when we read the script. I think as artists, we all read that script and felt like, oh my God, here's something we can say that has some meaning, that has a purpose, and maybe can open people's minds to a new way of thinking. And I think that, you know, Adriana was talking about that before. You know, John is. He understands Mexican culture because he understands human behavior. He understands that they're really, the differences that we think exist really don't exist. They exist in minute ways. They exist in the places that we live, or the foods that we eat, or the clothes that we wear, or, you know, the languages that we speak. But the reality is, we are all human beings, and we all want essentially the same things for ourselves, for the people we love. And I think that, you know, when you boil it down to the essence, the way that John does, you could make this family anything, anywhere, at any time. and somebody's going to be able to identify with it. And I'm glad that we're telling this Latino story, because there aren't enough of them being told. And so we do have the good fortune of telling that story here, and we have the good fortune of, most importantly, having a human being that understands humanity that's writing the story.
Yes.
Well said.
I think I what was also very interesting in watching City of Angels at this time is its depiction of the, you know, systemic problems inside the LAPD. Granted in the 1940s, but clearly you can sort of take a look at that and sort of apply it to the conversations we're having right now about the issues of police brutality and sort of at the heart of the Black Lives Matter movement and the marches in light of the murder of George Floyd. And Daniel and Adam, especially, I'd love to get your thoughts as actors, having played cops over the years, police. How, there is this conversation as well, how does Hollywood handle this in terms of depicting police and, walking that line? Your thoughts in sort of, what that means to you as an actor in playing a police officer and sort of not wanting to go down just that hero cop theme that we see a lot of in Hollywood, but also dive deeper into the issues that we're talking about right now.
Yeah, I mean, I've certainly played a lot of cops in my years of acting, and I think like with anything, especially as an actor, I mean, when you're going to play a role, you want to study the character, and the character is essentially the human being that you're going to embody and represent as that character. And, whether it's playing a bad guy or a perceived good guy, I think you're always looking for the full picture of who that person is, And I think that there are always going to be multiple facets to people. We as human beings have different ways of behaving in different situations, and we can really at our core be good people and get caught up doing bad things in a moment because we don't see ourselves in everybody else. And this is where I think all the flaw happens. I mean, this is what happens with government. This is what happens with anybody in a position of authority that doesn't exercise that authority in a responsibly. I think that you have to see yourself in everyone else. And when you're able to do that honestly, you will treat those people the way that you yourself want to be treated. I mean, I know it sounds so elementary, but I mean, the golden rule, if you're living your life, the golden rule, and you're practicing your profession and you live that rule, that's at the top of your list, to treat others the way you would like to be treated, then it's really hard to go wrong. I think what happens, unfortunately, is that there becomes this us versus them mentality. And this is hard to avoid. You become part of a group, whether that's a cultural group or you become part of a group that is a group with authority like the police, and you then feel like it's you guys are the good guys and everybody else is the bad guys, and you're going to have to deal with the bad guys a certain way, especially when you don't see yourselves in those perceived bad guys. Especially when you don't feel like, as a human being, you're able to relate to them, that you think of them as other than human or other than you. And this is something that I don't think that there's enough talk about. I certainly don't know how involved, this perspective is in the training of police. But we are seeing that that we're way off from where we need to be in order to have the police effectively serve the communities at large without bias. And, the shame of it is, of course, there are wonderful police out there that are dedicated to doing their job the right way. And because they want to serve the public that they are hired by and paid by to serve. And those people have it right. When you can police the community as a community member and feel like you are participating in making your community a better place, then yes, then that's the way to serve your community. But when you feel like you're entering the community you work in and it's a war zone and that's how you approach it, and everybody that you encounter is a potential enemy, then this is what's leading to the things that we're seeing so much of right now, And granted, I know that the majority of the police are not what we're seeing on the news, but there are way too many that are. And if the ones that aren't correcting the ones that are doing it wrong, then they're just as guilty of being, you know, of being wrong at the same time. And that needs to be corrected as well. Again, I think that the problem we're dealing with in Penny Dreadful is the same problem we're facing now in the country, is that, you know, we really just have to see each other as parts of ourselves, parts of our community, and really do our best to treat each other the way we would want our own children to be treated, or our own mothers and fathers to be treated by somebody else. And unfortunately, I know we're a long way away from that, but, you know, conversations like this and movements like Black Lives Matter movement and the other momentum that's currently going on right now, are hopefully going to make the kind of changes that need to be made, you know, and we'll see the results over time, hopefully in our lifetimes, hopefully.
Adam, I'm voting for you, whatever office you're running for.
I was about to say that.
I don't want that.
I literally was
too much responsibility, man.
He is my son. Love it, love it. Really. Love it.
Adriana, I want to ask you about your career is so interesting to me. You know, obviously as an actress, but also as a director and then as an acting coach. How does that, as someone who's done a lot of acting coaching, how does that play into when you're on a set? Do you have a certain style that you share with others? Is there a technique that you like to kind of, share with your co-stars, or do you kind of keep that separate?
No, you know, I am a old-fashioned actress. That director is my guide all the time. My guide, if my director wants to do something, I do something. Obviously, in a rehearsal, for example, I'm all the time arrive with my text, with my lines in my mind, and a lot of study, and with a proposal. But if the director doesn't want this proposal, okay, well, we can go to this way or this way. Maybe if I really want this proposal, obviously I can talk with my director. But you know, my director, and in this case, the director and John Logan's opinion, obviously, is so important for me, because I think in John Logan's case, is John Logan has the whole thing in his brain, in his mind, in his vision. And then I need to hear, and I try to understand. And then I am a good worker, you know, because I all the time try to do the director of my creator want all the time. I'm not director in the stage. Only if my partners, In that case, my child, my children, or in another stage, my other partners ask me something, is all the time, well, I think that, but all the time is, what the director tell you first? Okay, then I think you can do in this way, because I was a acting coach for many years, and one of the most important principle to be a coach is you have to know what the director wants. First of all, it's not your opinion as a coach. The most important opinion is the director. And then we have to know all the time what the director wants.
You're a director's dream. That's what they want to hear, right? Daniel, speaking of being in the presence of someone who might be able to coach you and someone who's a legend is working with Nathan Lane and getting to spend as much time as you did with Nathan Lane. You mentioned earlier that was sort of a nice bonus of this role is to spend some time with someone who's been acting longer than you've been alive, which, you know, we'll bring that up again. Talk a little bit about that. What was that experience like in working with Nathan? And what, if anything, did you learn from him?
Nathan is, he's like a big teddy bear. You know what I mean? You just want to go and hug him. He is so approachable. You know, for a man who is the king of Broadway, as I always tell him, like, you know, he's just there to do his job and to find the work with you. He and I share something that we're similar in, that we never leave a scene being like, we killed that. You know, we always leave the scene being like, we could have done this, we could have done that. You know, we're just constantly, you know, trying to figure it out and always trying to see where it could be. And that just, it encourages me to keep being that same way, because if that's how he is, after all that he's done, it just means that the man loves what he does, and he's passionate for what he does. He comes prepared. I mean, and he can turn it on and off like no other. You know, one second he's being Nathan with me, and then all of a sudden he does the eyebrows and he's Lewis. so, you know, it's just a beautiful thing to watch, because, you know, you can read all you want, you can study all you want, you can watch all the things you can, but being there next to him, I don't know, man, it's like watching Kobe shoot a three-pointer. Like, if you're there, you can see it, and it's different, you know, because it's tangible and you can see what he's doing. And then again, he just became a really good friend of mine, and till today, he's somebody that if I have anything, I can call him up, and he's just there for me. So that's just, you know, another perk to having, you know, the luck of working with all the cast that we have, and John Logan and Michael and everybody who made it seem like a family professionally. And usually it stays there, but with this one, like Adriana said, it kind of leaves set, and you got people to kind of confide with. So.
Yeah, and I do love, I mean, there is that surrogate father son relationship.
He is,
there.
He likes to be more like an uncle.
we're actually about to wrap things up, but I want to kind of go around real quick and get your sort of favorite moment from this first season. Going back to you know, if you can remember some of your favorite moments, Adam, you want to kick it off? What was sort of a favorite memory from season one of City of Angels?
Oh my God. Something that, anything at all, an anecdote or an actual scene?
Anything at all. Anecdote, okay. Scene, whatever you want to make.
Oh man, that is really hard to pick. I got to say, you know, I love,
you can have some time to think.
Yeah. I love the amount of time we got. And this was throughout the shooting, but Daniel mentioned that the amount of time we got to rehearse the scenes, the amount of time we got to spend with the material, and therefore with each other. I mean, we had two rehearsals, two really great long rehearsals, just for the first scene where the Vega family's introduced. And I got to say, that might be my favorite moment, only because it's the reference point that, you know, I remember rehearsing those scenes and shooting them, and, you know, we all had our feelings about the way it was all going, and I could tell you I didn't feel great about what I was doing in it at all. I hated what I did in the scene. I mean, with very deeply was unhappy. And but what I really remember about it was enjoying watching, especially our younger siblings in that scene, and they really, when I look back on it, it's why it's maybe one of my favorite moments, because I look back on it and they seem so young to me in that moment. And throughout the season, they all grew so much. They really transformed. They became just so much growth as people, as actors, and our relationships as friends, you know, grew so much that I think of that moment with a lot of fondness, because it was the beginning, you know.
Yeah. Daniel, how about you?
For me, I was gonna say, I think it was episode 9 where we were all in the same room, and it was because we didn't get to spend much time working in the same room. We got to spend a lot of time, Danny being with Adam and Adam being with, you know, us, but not as the characters. Our characters were kind of like, so it was really cool to kind of be in the same world that you've been thinking about these people and you know, substituting them, whatever your work process is. But then to have them there and to feel like this is really what we've been doing was really cool. I always liked whenever we got to dance. Whenever there's music and Adriana is involved, you'll have fun. So she loves to do it, you know what I mean? So it was a lot of fun whenever we got to be together and dance.
I just lost everyone. Yeah, that again, the nightclub at the set, I mean, we talked a little bit about just how amazing that whole setup looked. And Adriana, take us home, your favorite moment.
Well, you know, I have 8 months of favorite moments, 8 months, because, you know, as a Mexican actress, I need obviously to remember, it's not my language, obviously, it's not my, it was not my group, and it was not my jungle. And when I arrived, I discovered a wonderful group of people, and they embraced me, no matter what, if I Mexican, if I don't speak very well, if I don't understand. In that time, I didn't understand less than now. But you know, my favorite moment is that I have a wonderful time with these amazing people. To discover an amazing creator and friend, John Logan, and his beautiful sense of humor and his amazing way of create a story, because maybe you can think, oh my God, maybe John Logan is so dark. No, my God, John Logan is, I don't know, like a, I don't know, it's fun, yeah. He's light. Michael is amazing. Everything and everybody was a great, great moment. I work again with Adam because I was his mother in CSI many years ago. I discovered my children, my new children. I saw grew up my little ones as a human being, as Adam said, and as an actor, you know, discover in a new scene many, many days, many months, or many weeks later with Jonathan. And I say, oh my God, how great actor is he now? Oh my God. And everything, you know, Natalie was a wonderful people. And Nathan is really, really not only a great, great actor, I have only one scene with him. And I want more scenes with him.
Because sorry, Mom, I took them all.
But yes, but he's so funny. And everybody, you know. I live here in Miami, of course, but I never forget that I am Mexican. And when someone and when a group of American people embrace me, or the other country people embrace me, I really appreciate it. And toda mi vida voy a estar agradecida y muy, muy orgullosa de ese grupo.
All my life I will be very thankful and very honored to have been a part of Penny Dreadful. Yeah.
Queremos, mamá.
Yeah. Los quiero. Love you, my children.
Quiero, mamá.
All right, we'll catch up with the Vega family. Go back if you haven't watched City of Angels, Penny Dreadful, streaming all 10 episodes over at Showtime. Thank you so much, Adriana, Adam, Daniel. This was fantastic. Glad I could create a little bit of a family reunion for the three of you.
Thank you, Michael.
And good luck with everything. Yes, thanks, everyone. I'm Mike Schneider from Variety. Thanks for joining us here at the SAG-AFTRA Foundation.
Thank you very much.
Take care.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye.